Let's examine, if we can, the entire false flag scenario. Potentially, it could be a very big issue coming up. Okay, so let's take a look at that. Just after the last video I made, gathering the will, we had a conversation with some people, family members, and something came up. A lot of triggers came up, and I will get into this video. You need a little patience on this video to work this through, because we're going to talk about potential false flag scenarios, okay? And there is a potential for this, all right? There most definitely is. And it, you know, the storyline of existence can become very strange indeed, because it's based on severe projection, severe self-deception. The last several videos, maybe two or three ago, I brought to light some of the issues of the Judeo-Christianity and how things are not, don't quite add up there, right? They don't quite add up. And this can play a big, big role in what's coming up as far as a false flag situation. To start out with, let us use an example of the past. Let us say there's a dictatorship, and I happen to know of a situation, testimony from people who've lived through this actually. So I know what I'm talking about here. Let's say a dictator takes over and there's opposition, and people don't like the control. They're trying to control everything, what you can say, do, where you go, who you meet with, affiliate, what you say, controlling all that. And there are those who don't like that. And they say, look, no, I want to be able to say what I want to say. I want to oppose this. I say I want a different way of life. I have different values, etc. Okay. What happens is the dictator wants to get rid of those who are opposing them. So what they do, let's take an example. A car comes up to your house, and a couple of officials come out, and they knock on the door, and they say, we want to have a conversation, have a little talk with so-and-so. So if you please come with us, we're going to take you to a nice place, and we're going to sit down, and we're going to have a talk. We want to explain our position. We want to hear what you have to say. We just have a nice conversation. Okay, so come with us. You got to come with us, and we're going to have a talk. Okay, people say, what's going on here? Okay. Now, instead of going to a nice place, they actually drive out into the boondocks, okay, way out in the desolate places. Now, that's the first part. The second part is that they're running this scheme called the good cop, bad cop scheme on you. Now, one or two, maybe one guy, let's say one guy there is the maniac. And they begin talking to this person. Maybe they put him in a little shack, a little place out in the boondocks, a little tent, or even in the car. And they're interrogating them. We heard you said this, we heard you said that. And one guy is like very much the bad cop, very threatening. Says, the person is fearing for their lives. They think they're going to be shot. They pull a gun out, you know, and interrogate him like that. And the person is terrified. Then what happens is the bad cop gets up and needs to go to the bathroom or something, gets a call or something, and says, I'll be right back. And as soon as they leave, the good cops come up to him and say, hey, listen, this guy, he's crazy, he's a killer. I'm telling you, your life is in danger, this is really bad. But we don't agree with this. We understand that you're just a good citizen like anyone else, and you just maybe said a few things you shouldn't have said, but you know, we don't want to see you die here. That's wrong. That is wrong. So, look, now's your only chance. You need to run for it. You need to take off, and you need to try to run for it. That is one variation. Now, what happens is when you panic and say, okay, better go for it, and you start running for it, then what do they do? They're waiting for you, actually. It's all set up. Once you run for it, say, hey, you know, come back, and you say, oh, why, and you say, run more, boom, shoot you in the back. Trying to escape. You were under official custody. You tried to escape. And so they shot you. Now, that's one variation. The other variation, there's a number of variations, is when the bad cop leaves, the good cop say, "Hey, look, he's gonna shoot you. You know, this is what happens. But we don't think this is right. So here's a gun, and you defend yourself, okay?" So they give you a gun, and so when the bad cop comes back in, and he says, "Hey, what's going on here?" and pulls out a gun, you know, like that. Then the other person in self-defense pulls the gun that they were given and tries to shoot him. Guess what? The gun is empty. And the bad cop, boom! Self-defense. Okay, now these are obvious ploys. They claim a rationale of they were just trying to talk with you and it was self-defense. Or you tried to escape their custody and they had warned you not to do that. Okay. That's the rationale. So, now, pretty simple, right? Now, here's the big twist to the whole thing. Again, this group comes into a house, a neighborhood, and make a big to-do of where they are, what they're doing, and all the neighbors are looking, and they knock on a door, and they bring out some prominent person or something, says, "We want to talk with you," and people say, "Uh-oh." Sometimes people never come back, and we heard that they tried to shoot, you know, they fought against these, fought them. It says, okay. So they take this person away. Later on, they come back, bring the person back, and everyone says, "Wow, what happened? They said, "No, these people are very nice to me, and they just wanted to talk, and they just were concerned about where I stood on the issues and stuff, and I just explained to them that I disagree with something." They said, "Well, that's okay, it's not a big deal. We just want you to tone things down." And they're very nice, there's no problems. No, I didn't feel threatened or anything like that, it was fine. And the people say, "Oh, okay, that's good." Meanwhile, the disappearances keep happening. And they are told that these people tried to fight them, and that's why they were shot in self-defense, or they tried to escape and they were shot because of that. And so these stories get back like you need to be really nice. If you're just nice, everything's fine. If you're just nice, everything is fine. Meanwhile, people keep disappearing, right and left, never to come back. So what is going on here? What is going on? What is going on is the people that do come back are accomplices. Okay, they're accomplices. They're intentionally brought away and to come back to plan a story that if you're just nice and don't try to escape or don't try to fight them or anything, nothing happens to you. And so then everybody thinks, "Oh, okay, you just gotta be very compliant, very passive, very nice, and everything will be fine." Okay. So once they've set that up, whole situation up, then the people just start disappearing. There's no story even given about it. And people just say, "Oh, well, they must have tried to escape or did something wrong." Right? So this is the mechanism, the psych job on people using accomplices. Okay, this is the key thing. Accomplices to say everything's fine. Now let's turn fast forward that to this day and age. Possible false flag rapture. Okay, let us say there's all these spaceships that show up, extraterrestrials, and people start going up to the ships. Somehow they're being lifted up off the planet. We say this. Everyone says this is the rapture. Wow. And a lot of people they don't come back. And there's some word. People start worrying like, "Whoa, what's going on? Is this safe?" And then what happens is you have someone lifted up to the ships. And then they do come back. Some do come back. Very charismatic, convincing type of people. And they say, "I went up to the ship, and Jesus was there." Or, "I went up to the ship and Mother Mary was there. I went up to the ship and this great, great, you know, spiritual master, ascended masters were there." He says, "Oh, the ship is great." And what happens to the other people? Oh, they were shifted into another dimension, or they ascended. There's ascension chambers, so they all ascend. So these people go back in the world and they're telling everybody, you know, everything's fine. The rumors are totally untrue. This is all the rapture. This is the rapture, and Jesus is there, and he's charge of it. And so what happens? More and more of the Christians start to get on board, and other people around the world get on board with this and saying that this is it. This is the rapture. And so they go up to the ships. They agree. Their will says, okay, it's my will that this happens. Well, it is quite possible that this is a false rapture. And that the people are not ascending. They're being shredded. They're being vaporized up there. And that the people who come back to this world and say everything's great, everything's fine, no problem, they're worshiped like gods. Everyone's like, say, oh my gosh, you've seen that Jesus? He's up there in the ship, and everything is wonderful. And they go around the world, you know, telling everybody how wonderful everything is. They could be accomplices, actually, accomplices to this whole program, this false flag rapture, to basically get people to willingly just be eliminated, to leave this planet and be shredded. So all of this inconvenient religious stuff in the world, gone. See, not here anymore. No war, no battle, no problems. This is a possibility. This is what was shown to me as a possibility. So I'm just floating this out there. In just 1 minute, I have to take a break here. So, now here is the twist to the whole situation. And before I tell you this, keep in mind that self-deception that we're engaged in, the Spirit, the Son of God, the Spirit of God, is trying to turn the tables on creation, on the Prime Creator, and become the new Prime Creator. And this is involves the belief this is possible involves massive self-deception. That self-deception loves to do things in a way that tricks itself. It gets its will aligned with what's happening. It doesn't like brutality, hard, heavy-handed brutality. It loves trickeration, to trick, to deceive, and it does things that way. So the twist of all of this is that eventually some accomplices confess, and they say, at some point they say, you know what, this was all a cruel hoax, and all those people have been exterminated, and they're spread throughout the world like wildfire, and people say, oh my gosh, the rapture is a complete hoax, how terrible. Say, so now what? Well, if, let's say, there was a true rapture, a true leaving of this planet, all those who didn't go up to the ships are now thinking, oh my gosh, it's rapture is a hoax. There is no such thing. And then their will feels like, I have to stay here. You see, it traps your will here. So actually, the strange thing is this whole situation could be in cahoots, the two sides, the whole thing. The aim is to get those who genuinely are seeing that their will is free, unbound, is to trick them into thinking that it's all a cruel hoax, not possible, and get them to stay, at which point they would be subject to elimination here. Very, very diabolical sort of cleverness. That's exactly the kind of cleverness that the ego loves. The ego loves this cleverness. So I've been like looking at this saying, wow, this is a possibility actually. Why? Because the Christians as they stand now, keep in mind that most Christians, the Christianity as we know it now is due to the so-called conversion of severe pagans, but that conversion was off basically due to the fact they got defeated in battle, and they felt that those Christians who defeated them had some special power, and the Christians that defeated them said, yeah, that we eat the flesh and drink the blood of our God every day. And the pagans, that was right down their alley, because they felt that you could get some special mana or power out of eating the flesh of something powerful. That's part of their mythology. So they felt that they were defeated because the enemy had a superior power, because they were eating the flesh and drinking the blood of this God. And so that if they converted to that, they would be successful in battle too. They'd be successful in acquiring whatever they wanted to acquire. And after they died, they would go to a paradise. So this notion has crept in, has become the new Christianity, modern Christianity. But in ancient times, at Jesus' time, it wasn't like that. It wasn't like that. Actually, Christianity has truth at the heart of it. It has very high teaching, actually. But you have to be very, very tuned into it to get it. And the Holy Spirit has to show it to you very clearly. Otherwise, it can get off track, like any teaching. So, in the modern world, you have this belief in this sort of situation. So, that's really egoic. It's really very much egoic. And the whole sacrificial thing, the idea is to actually kill spirit. Okay. So, what they're trying to do is those who are attuned to realization that our will has never been bound, can never be bound, and the vision of oneness is only the vision of oneness saves us. And you can call it the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, same thing. But what they're trying to do is they're trying to crush their will, crush their spirit, so the point that they despair and commit suicide. This is the ego's whole plan, is to get spirit to commit suicide, to die. So it is very, very possible, even likely, that both sides in this whole false rapture thing are actually working together for the purpose of trying to drive others into despair. So, just a heads up on this whole thing. It seems very diabolical, doesn't it? But existence is very diabolical. It's self-deception. It is really self-deception. Anyone who believes that their will can be hostage to anything is following the egoic belief, is actually wanting that to be true, to prove that there is some will stronger than them, which means there's some will stronger than God, because our will is actually one with God. God created our will to be the same will that God has. So to say that there's some will that's holding us hostage means we believe there's some power greater than God, which is, of course, since we're projecting it, we think that we've created God, a new God that's greater than God. We don't realize the demands that this projection makes upon us. That's not, we disconnect between the two. We don't have a clear, we realize there's something wrong, but we don't put it together because of the continuity fear. We're afraid if we put it together, we'll say, oh, this is just a joke, it's self-deception, poof, no, don't need it anymore. So because of our continuity fear, we don't put two and two together. But we know there's this very nasty dynamic going on. There's something that's trying to annihilate us or convince us to commit spiritual suicide. And so out of fear of the continuity problem, out of fear of that, we try to appease that dynamic. And then before we become accomplices in this dynamic, and therefore easily we find a scapegoat of this dynamic would not be here if not for those people there who are actually truly oriented towards spirit. They say, no, we got to convince them to commit suicide, then we will be liberated. So this whole false rapture possible scenario is really designed to totally dispirit those who actually do feel that they do want to truly ascend. Okay. Now, one other twist to the whole thing. If you can wrap your mind around this, I've been spending some hours just kind of just like, wow, look at this. It is very possible that the real rapture happens before the false rapture. Before. Okay, it happens before. This is what I'm considering as a real strong possibility. That those who are clued in and warned about the false rapture will go somewhere first, before this all happens, so that they do not get caught up in all of this song and dance and big show. How about that? They don't wait. They wait around. They're warned in advance. There is going to be this false rapture designed to demoralize the true, those who are oriented towards truth. So those who are oriented towards truth, they leave. They go somewhere before the false rapture even happens. Okay, this is it's possible. This just came up. Poof, as a package realization just a couple of hours ago. At this point, it it has some possibility. You know, I said, like, wow, this is possible. If they're going to be raptured, they're going to be raptured. But if you look at their ideology, it's a totally egoic. So it could only be a false rapture. If they were raptured, it could only be a false rapture. And that false rapture could only be designed to try and demoralize and try to stop a true rapture from happening. So the true rapture may happen before the false rapture. And the false rapture will mean much ado about nothing, actually. It might even help them cool it a little bit. Accomplices who will come into the world and say, hey, I was on the ships and everything's great. And these people will be looked up to as great saints and great masters and ascended masters coming in the world, and people will bow to them. And the ego ET hold the whole plot has been looking for those who are willing to play that role. Okay. And that's the temptation of the devil, so to speak, is you could be seen, if you play that role, you could be seen as like an ascended master, that you're coming down from the ships, telling everybody everything is great, everything is fine. I've been on board, I'm witnessing to everything that's happening. The reason why they're not coming back is because they've gone on to, you know, to paradise. And then convince the world, and people would look at you as you're like a god, you know, like bringing them the great good news. You could be like a hero, you know, play this role. Definitely the ETs have been looking for something like that, because they definitely tried to push me in that direction. And I said, you know, something doesn't smell right about this whole thing. But fear of the continuity problem prevents you from putting two and two together. No, you just, it's disassociated. So you say, okay, I see giving people good news is fine, and I know that there is ascension is a possibility and all this kind of stuff. I say, oh, wait a minute, but wait a minute, there's something else that doesn't add up here. And so it seems maybe the Holy Spirit has sort of said, okay, now you're ready for two and two to be fit together. And that's really quite something. And of course, if you warn people about this, that's a false rapture, then you'd be attacked here and saying you're trying to prevent people from going to paradise, and that you're one of the evil ones or something like that. See? You're in a very bad position, because these grandiose ascended spiritual masters coming down from the spaceships, everybody say, oh my God, look at this, this is incredible. They'll be saying the opposite, saying, no, everything's fine, this other person is lying and deceiving and trying to prevent you from going. You should deal harshly with them. So you'd be in a very bad situation if this were so. So if you know what's really going on, you would want to be raptured, truly ascended, relocated prior to all this happening. So you would not be here and be put in that situation. Possibility. I don't know if it's true. We're just looking at this as a possibility. And it certainly fits a lot of parameters. Because having truly looked within and seen what's within, I'm aware of others. Have they looked within? Have they seen through this whole charade of projection, perception, personality, ego? It's all a projection. The fact that will cannot be held hostage, you know, and the vision of oneness is the only way to be reminded of reality. And I've experienced the vision of oneness. I know what it is. Knowing all this stuff, and have others seen the same thing? If they haven't, and they're claiming all these attributes, you know, for Jesus and for their saviors or whatever they call them, then you know, they're easily deceived and tricked, and they're part of the whole deception. They have to be part of it. They're still wanting the death of God, plain and simple. Plain and simple. Which means they will actually go like lemmings to their own death, thinking it's their salvation and thinking that it's doing done to bring about the death that they really are aiming for, which is the death of spirit, annihilation, eternal death of spirit, which they think will then free them to be the new prime creator. You know, but they haven't yet connected these dots because of the continuity problem. They don't want to connect them because they think that will catapult them back into awareness of reality as it is, and they won't know how to function, you know. So the continuity problem is a very abrupt, hard landing into a new experience that you have no familiarity with, and you can't relate it to anything that came before. That's called the continuity problem. And because of that, we continue to be like fools, believing in the massive deception that we perpetrate upon ourselves. But if you work on the continuity problem for very dedicated and long enough time, you begin to see through all this stuff. So the way that this cosmic deception works, and the ETs are involved in this too, is they love to trick. They love this type of cleverness. They feel this cleverness is a sign of their own divinity. And so they don't want to just come down with machine guns blazing, taking out everybody, rounding them up in cattle cars and all this kind of stuff. They much prefer that you go of your own will, so to speak, that you choose thinking that it's your salvation. That's what they much prefer. So it's likely that they have set up something like this. Very, very likely. This is how they roll. That's how they operate. And they do things through accomplices, tricky accomplices, telling everybody, yeah, this is great. This is what you want. Everything's fine. There's other people. They're lying. Don't listen to them. They view this cleverness as a sign of their own brilliance and identity. That's not to say that some heavy-handedness doesn't take place too. It does. But they prefer more elegant. There's a level of, there's a much more elegant, tricky situation. They kind of feel like, no, they went on their own choice. It's their own fault, kind of thing. It's, they deserve what they got. So you have to wonder if all of this stuff hasn't been set up ahead of time through the twisted ideology that's been taught in this world. It could very well be a true rapture, a genuine one, a genuine relocation, and there could also be a false one. The false flag is designed to discredit the true situation, the true opportunity, ahead of time. It's supposed to come in ahead of time, set up this situation that seems to undermine the credibility of the true option that we have, so that people don't take it. The ego knows we have a true option. It feels threatened by this. It doesn't want us to take that true option, so it sets up a false flag operation to undermine the credibility of the true option. I'm for sure this is how the ego works. I've noticed this throughout my entire life, is just as various clarities coming to light, the ego, there's something in the world that is orchestrated to discredit it. And I've noticed that hundreds and hundreds of times. It's the underlying root type of dynamic where the ego feels threatened with something coming to light. It will orchestrate something to throw a cloud of confusion and discredit on what's legitimate. I guarantee this is how the ego works. So if there is going to be a true rapture, I would almost bet there's going to be a false one too. A false one trying to discredit the true one. And the true one may happen before the false one even happens, just to avoid this trap. Could very well be so. This is very heavy information. I haven't thought of this before. Really have not. But it does fit a lot of my concerns that I've noticed. And are there really accomplices who would do such a thing? Absolutely, there are. There are people who, just to get a sense of personality, glory, they crave it so much that they're willing to sell out everybody just to get that. They'll do anything, say anything, just to get the power, just to get the glory. And of course, they think they're going to be heroes to everybody that's here in the world. They said, "Yeah, I'm going to be a great hero of the revolution. I was able to get, you know, a billion people to leave the planet, or, you know, something like that, and get rid of all the ones that were unruly, hard to control." And they may rationalize it, thinking that is all perfectly fine. So, are there people like that? Sure, there are. Absolutely, there are. And some of these accomplices, we think, who is it? Well, it's not just men. A lot of them could be women, actually, which is harder to deal with. Because if a man says something, you say, well, let's hold this up to critical judgment. It's very interesting in the world right now that basically we're being taught not to be critical of women, okay? Not to be critical of them, not to hold them up to the same standard of scrutiny as men, saying that that's bullying them, or it's painting them in a bad light as if they were somehow bossy or something like that, right? But of course, men are held up, we feel perfectly okay to hold them up to very strict standards and grill them and say, hey, where's your proof? Where's your evidence? Maybe you're a liar, maybe you're a deceiver, you know? But we're being taught as a culture that is completely taboo as far as women are concerned. That this is sexist, it's a war against women. All of this has permeated our psyche to such a point, if women came down from the spaceships and said, hey, everybody, I tell you, on the life of my children, for sure, everything is fine. Everything is great. You can completely trust that everything's fine. No worries whatsoever. And they're very beautiful, beautifully dressed, elegant women. And they just, you know, who in the world could say, hey, wait a minute, I think this is a lie. I think this is deception. Let's grill this person and let's find out what the evidence really is. Why should we just take their word for something like that? The world has been totally conditioned not to do that. Not to do that. They've also been conditioned not to believe men, especially if they disagree with women. If there's a disagreement, if he said, she said, we've been totally conditioned to believe the she in this world. Now let's say there's some men that say, hey, wait a minute, this is a false flag, rapture, all these people are being incinerated. Shredded and incinerated. This person's telling you that it's okay is a liar. And the person happens to be a man saying that. And the person says it's all okay is a woman. The world has been conditioned to believe the woman. Definitely. Anybody can just check that out for themselves. The default position is the woman is right. They're telling you the truth. It's the men who are wrong. It's the men who are lying to you. Now, I had this pointed out to me over a decade ago. Maybe it's been about 12, 13 years. I was watching television, the Holy Spirit said, hey, you know, you gotta, before I stop, I said, pay attention to all the commercials. So I just did, I just watched the commercials and then said, what are you seeing? And I said, what do you mean? What do you see? Well, what's standing out to you? And I said, well, I am noticing something. I'm noticing that in almost all the commercials, maybe 9 out of 10, the man is being portrayed as the lying, deceiver, idiot person, who incompetent, bad person. And the woman is being portrayed as the one telling the truth and having the right poise, the right mental attitude, and the one who's solving our problems. I said, 90%. I said, it's incredible. What's going on? The Holy Spirit said, just pay attention to that. It's very important. And then later on, it said, okay, stop watching TV. You've seen enough. But over the years, occasionally, I would check back in. They said, just take a look. How is it? Same thing. Non-stop. I'd say maybe the last 15 years, this has been the case. Non-stop. That the woman is always the one who is right. the man is always the one who is wrong. And there's various ways to depict this. They give all sorts of variations on this. That ultimately, for truth, we turn towards to the woman for truth. This sets up a situation where this false rapture, that women can come down and say everything's fine, everything's great, and the whole world will believe them. And if the man says no, it's not true, they won't be believed. They will not be believed. You see, why is it so important? Because if you look at nature, it's always the male that goes ahead of the female to check for danger. If you look at dogs, you look at very sociable animals, the birds, I noticed the birds hopping around here. First, two birds arrive in a tree, okay, looking for food on the ground. The first one that goes down is always the male bird. It goes down, looks around, hops around. The female's waiting up in the tree. Finally, the bird says, hey, signals that, yeah, there's all kid up here, then psh, the female comes down. That's how nature is, because the female has the eggs, not the male. If the male's expendable. If the male dies, the female will find another male. Where if the female dies, all those eggs, potential, you know, eggs are gone, okay? So that's how it's set up, and that's the way it's always been in human culture, too. The male is the pioneer. He goes out in the territory. Are there any hostiles, wild animals, hostile people, dangerous diseases, etc.? They clear the land. They deal with all the dangerous stuff, and then the females come out and say, okay, let's start some families out here. You built the nest out here. It's safe. So men are, by nature, more skeptical. They have to be, because they've been facing the uncertain danger of uncertainty constantly. So we're saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, let's assess this very carefully. There could be a big problem here. Whereas the women, they come to where the house is already built, the nest is already built, by and large. The dangers are cleared out, the hostilities are cleared out. And you're out there on the frontier, all the soldiers are fighting and battling for the frontier. And then once they've been, you know, the enemy's been wiped out, and forts established and everything, then the trainloads of women come out, and they're all happy and dressed up nice, and they realize the danger's gone. The men took care of it. Everything's okay. The men tell them, they ask the men, is everything okay? They say, yeah, don't worry. Okay, I won't worry. So, of course, the attitude is very different. The male attitude is, we're going to go in around the bend here in the river, and then pirates may be right there, so we got to say, whoa, wait a minute. Let's look for signs. Let's look, you know, let's do some clever testing here. Let's not just run into an ambush. So men are inherently much more resistant to this type of false flag rapture than women are. Much more resistant. And it wouldn't work if people believed men. It wouldn't work. But what happened was the ETs, I believe, have conditioned, and their lackeys in this world, conditioned the world to feel that this male caution about this issue, this male caution, this natural, and the ability of men to suss out some sort of ambush, this is all, it's been demonized. It's been said that men are just idiots, that they're these foolish knuckleheads who waste a lot of time worrying about stuff they shouldn't worry about, whereas the women already know the truth about everything. And you can save a whole lot of time if you just turn to the women and ask them, and they'll tell you straight out the whole scoop on everything. That's the essential message of this. So when this false flag rapture happens, if it does, it could be marketed by women, these ascended female masters coming into the world and saying, everything's fine, we don't have a lot of time though, so let's go. And the people won't even turn to men and say, what do you think about it? They won't even turn to them. You know, say, you guys, you know, you just need to get off the program here. You know, and men will say, oh yeah, okay, we've been trained for that. We're now trained monkeys, you know, to just go along with whatever women say. So it's the ability of men to see through traitorous tricky disguises and ambushes ahead of time, which we have certainly had to learn through millennia of terrible situations, where we're able to see ahead of time potential ambushes and problems and avoid them. It's that which has been under attack on this planet for about the last 15 years, very extremely. Actually, it's the last 50 years, but the last 15, it's been embedded in all media now, all media. As a matter of fact, if you look, when I see these news people now, it's being more and more and more dominated by women. It's incredible how dominated it is by women now. And my honest reaction is I don't trust them at all. I do not trust them. This is not a sexist thing at all, because if there is a woman speaking truthfully, I'll say, great, fine, no problem at all. But these particular women that dominate the news industry now, who are actually moderators, you know, you see like a panel, who's moderating it? Almost always it's a are being moderated by women. The whole thing is being put in the hands of women. I don't trust him. I don't trust him at all. I think it's a setup. Okay, it's a setup, so that they will be broadcasting to everyone in the world. Say, don't worry, everybody. This is all legit. This is all fine. Let the Christians go. This is good. They should go. This is their rapture. This is the everything is fine on the ships, etc. And they will be the ones promoting all of this, and everybody will just believe what they have to say. See, every time I see a woman on the news, I'm saying, okay, no problem. Then suddenly I say, wait a minute, I don't trust this person. There's something about them which is, they're saying, believe me because I'm a woman. Don't believe me because what I say is true, but believe me because I'm a woman. Because I'm a woman, what I'm saying has to be true, has to be valid. I'm saving you time. I say, no, you're not. You're just reading a script. You're all made up to look like you're beautiful, and we're supposed to trust and believe you, and you got your ornamentations on, you got showing a lot of, you know, flesh on your arms and shoulders, and you're looking so, you know, slinky and all this, and say, wait, why should I believe you? You're telling me to go around the bend into some ambush, and I'm supposed to believe you? So a red flag comes up and says, wait a minute, I don't trust them, absolutely not. So the whole flavor of this modern age now has this flavor of a false rapture. It really does, of a massive deception on this planet. And, you know, just where are those men, just those kind of hard-bitten, frontier-like men, you know, where are they on the media? Where are they? They've disappeared entirely. Where's the man that stands up and says, hey, you know, wait a minute, why should I believe anything you're saying? You could be a liar, you could be a deceiver. Let's vet you very carefully here. You know, where's that frontier mentality? You know, that, so, out here on the final frontier, one of the final, California was one of the last, was still a frontier, and, you know, rugged people kept coming out here, out in the West here. We have this culture of trusting men and trusting him to the fact of putting them to the test, put their knowledge to the test. You know, are you lying? Are you telling me the truth? Come on, man. And we confront issues and say, what's the facts really? Okay, let's get to the bottom of this situation. And so we're tough. Men can be very tough with other men, very tough, because their lives depend on it, the lives of women depend on it, the lives of their children depend upon it. So where is that toughness in the media from the male side? Non-existent. Totally non-existent. Where are these tough male journalists right now? You got a bunch of metrosexual males running, you know, having token power with the females running the show. And these guys, I don't trust them either at all. Don't trust them at all. I really feel like the media is super deceptive and are setting us all up for a very big false flag operation. And this frontier attitude of let's make sure there's not an ambush around the corner has all been demonized and marginalized and laughed away like, hey, we all live in a modern world. We don't need to worry about that kind of stuff. We don't need to be cautious. We don't need to ask hard questions. All this softball puff, powder puff questions on the media now is just utterly ridiculous. It's all staged. It's all an act. I don't buy any of it. And you supposedly got these hard-hitting journalists and stuff. No way. Most of the men are so effeminate, it's pathetic. You know, really, this massive effeminization of the planet is, I believe, designed to get us to drop our guard. To get us to drop our guard as a planet. As a planet. And I know that I was demonized my whole life because I would ask the tough questions. I'd say, hey, you know, And people didn't like that. They said, no, 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 we're not going in that direction anymore. That's passé. You know, look where we are now. Look where we are now. So I think this whole planet has been duped and set up for this false flag operation to try and crush the spiritual will of this planet entirely. So people even give up that they have any hope or any options whatsoever, and that their belief that there's a better place or a better way is a huge operation on many levels, but it's just going to be an overwhelming type of crush on the planet. And people really will succumb to it, though the spiritual will succumb to it. It's already succumbed to a large extent, but there's still, the embers are still there. They could come back, you know, so they want to extinguish the whole thing. So maybe a true ascension relocation prior to all this false flag stuff is a strong possibility. And of course, people say, why are you leaving now? The rapture hasn't happened yet. And they will claim that this is the false rapture. But the one that happens before the false rapture, those who are setting up this false rapture, will claim that this true one is false and that their one is true and that you're missing the true one and therefore you must be going to your destruction. They project it on you. They project their own plans, which is to bring people into destruction. They project, because they don't want that to be pinned on them. They say, no, this early rapture, the true rapture, that's the false one, and you're going to be incinerated and shredded and ground up and incinerated. So what they say about that is actually what they are planning. That is a possibility. And they're trying to prevent anybody from leaving early, you see, that kind of thing. So all of this stuff fits the modern age, doesn't it? It fits the dynamics of the situation, how things have evolved, how things are going. This is amazing. It's amazing. Heavy stuff. Very, very heavy stuff. All right. We will leave you to contemplate this, and I'm sure I will. I don't know what else I have to say. At some point, this just came up like this. So pass it on. Give it some thought. Give it some consideration. And just stay in the mood of repentance. Center yourself with this moment just as it is. It's totally free of all specialness. Totally free of all specialness. This is a specialness-free day. All my thoughts are totally free of all specialness. My will is not bound by anything that arises. My will is eternally and inherently eternally free. I cannot give my will away. I cannot give my life away. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness sets me free. I choose the vision of oneness. I align my valuing with the vision of oneness. And just center yourself that way. So, I'm telling you, things are far along right now in this entire situation. So we'll see what comes next. All right, that's it.